Simon & Schuster Audio presents Black Joy, stories of resistance, resilience, and restoration by Tracey Michae’l Lewis-Giggetts, read by the author.
To Michaela, may your joy always be limitless and liberating. There is no time for despair, no place for self-pity, no need for silence, no room for fear. We speak, we write, we do language. That is how civilizations heal. Toni Morrison, The Nation, March 23rd, 2015. Introduction. Does joy have a color? Tracey, you're not very kind to yourself. I remember those words as clearly as if it happened today. About 6 years ago, I came to my now former pastor for guidance. His office was draped in rich, dark browns with black leather chairs and tasteful gold accents. I chose the sorrel leather couch that sat ominously in the middle of the room, sure that it had seen its share of tears and maybe sweat. The pastor perched behind a huge wooden desk that dwarfed his laptop. A globe and thick text lined the bookshelves that took up nearly all of one wall. In hindsight, it was a lot to take in. You know how a room and place speaks to you, tells you about its owner, reveals the nature of its work? This office was that kind of place. And yet my mind was somewhere else. My heart was looking for something, anything, and hoping I'd find it in that office. Yes, I'd come because I needed help sorting through some specific challenges, but I also wanted to figure out a larger direction that made sense, a path that felt divine. I found myself in a place where all of the hats I was wearing, all of my identities, writer, wife, teacher, mother, were colliding into one another, and I needed a kind of extraction from a reality that, frankly, I'd manufactured. So his words startled me. Shook is probably more accurate. "I don't know what you mean," I said. I mean, I did, but who wants to concede something like that? Admittedly, this man and I would eventually butt heads on a number of things. Theology, his leadership style, and normally I'd be ready to debate. I found myself often anticipating something off coming from him. But his simple statement, couched in a conversation about my life purpose, unearthed an understanding I'd chosen to not acknowledge. It hit me hard because it was true. I was not kind to myself at all. There were a myriad of ways I could have been kind to myself, extending myself grace when a mistake was made, asking for what I want, or resting when I knew I'd been grinding too hard. This rejection of self-compassion was an interesting position to be in when you consider that I'd done all the things. I'd written about the healing power of creativity and art from a cultural standpoint, spoken on numerous platforms about racial justice and reconciliation, named myself a curator of Black joy through the arts. I knew how to be happy. I knew what Black joy should look like. I could manufacture it at the drop of a dime. But I struggled with true compassion for myself. My critiques of every minute detail, the way I looked, moved, laughed, what I enjoyed, and my work, my writing, teaching, were swift. They were harsh. I worked myself into the ground for outside validation so I could feel the love and acceptance I should have been able to give myself. I had all the makings of Black joy, but no recognition of it as something inherent to me, and therefore had no ability to hold it for a lifetime. Gratefully, this has changed for me. I hope it changes for many of us. For me, the change shows up as the dancing and bed jumping I do with my 9-year-old daughter on one of our mommy-daughter trips to Atlantic City, tapping into a purity of delight that I never before gave myself permission to experience feels like a warm hug on a cold day. Other times, it's the cheesy grin that comes across my face while watching my favorite nighttime drama. I'm a sucker for good storytelling, and choosing to enjoy a show as opposed to dissecting it is a gift. The feeling of joy in my body is intense and weighty and necessary. And in the end, most of the moments I've taken to embrace joy and self-compassion are wrapped in my cultural understanding of who I am as a Black woman. When attempts are made to define what liberation and equity looks like for Black people, we often hear the language of striving and collective burdens. And rightfully so. Our history is filled with the evidence that struggle and dogmatic persistence has been integral to our 400-year-long freedom project. But as more and more studies reveal, the lens of struggle as the means to freedom has not come without a cost. The physical, psychological, and spiritual impact of racial trauma has often found us crossing the finish line of every battle, war-torn and broken from the inside out. As a writer, storyteller, and Black contemplative, I'm not sure I can ignore this for much longer, especially when there is another significant tool in our arsenal. One that not only deeply disturbs the racist systems we are trying to dismantle, but also offers a direct path to healing and wholeness as we do so. That weapon is powerful and all-encompassing and necessary. That weapon is joy. Plenty are the conversations happening right now about Black joy, the power of it, the necessity of it, the ways in which this very cultural demonstration of humanity counters mainstream narratives of Black life being solely comprised of trauma and hardship. That said, there is an aspect of Black joy that is too often overlooked and/or missing from the discourse, mostly because it forces Black people to look inward as opposed to outward for the validation of our joy. In order for Black joy to have longevity, for it to live both alongside and beyond our movements, it must be firmly founded in self-compassion and empathy within each individual. No doubt, we Black folks look outside ourselves for that validation for good reason. Historically, we've been dehumanized and dismissed as inferior. So through our demonstration of joy, we hope to be seen as fully human. We want our laughter to be contagious instead of treated like an audible plague. We want our dances, our food, our stories to be centered and not just commodified or colonized. And yet the most powerful thing we can do is believe all of this ourselves first. To be absolutely clear about our own humanity. To offer ourselves all the grace and benefits of the doubt that other humans receive. This is self-compassion. It requires us to create an infrastructure for the evidence and impact of Black joy in our individual lives that is rock solid before we ever seek external acknowledgement. My inclination that day to push back hard against my pastor's candid words reflected what I already knew about myself. I had a deep desire for validation positioned within a nearly non-existent framework of empathy and grace for myself. Even a simple compliment was often hard for me to process. Someone could say to me, "You did a great job," or "I really like that dress you had on," or something as simple as, "I like your hair." And I'd instinctually want to add a caveat to turn that kindness into something I was not worthy of. I'd want to somehow mitigate their compliment just in case something went wrong. My inability to give myself kindness and receive it was an issue of not feeling worthy of it. So even though I hungered for these kindnesses, I had to work really hard to receive them, even from myself. It was a dynamic of longing for validation and wanting to properly process the positivity that came my way, but not being able to take it in. If this showed up in my daily life, how much more would it show up in my work? or in the cyber communities where so many of us spend time. I couldn't hold properly the likes and shares I got on social media because there was no self-love sustaining me. There was no compassion for myself and my journey, and so inevitably, there was no way to hold any success. But actually, there was. I just couldn't see it. Being a Black woman, I had a portal to self-compassion and ultimately joy that I'd yet to recognize. Black joy was ever present but hidden behind and under the trauma that I wore like a badge. Self-compassion for ourselves as individuals creates a collective self-compassion that can support the demonstrations of our joy. The historical experience of Black folks in this country made being kind to ourselves a challenge. We did not have time to tend to our emotional and psychological wounds while dodging the master's whip.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.